echaron o lo hicieron.
All right, so they cast it. In any other versions, does it not say that they cast the net?
No.
We got it right here. It says cast, right? Yes means yes?
Yes.
Yes, it says cast. Okay, good.
¿Por qué los discípulos dijeron, no, espérate, vamos a orar una semana, vamos a ayunar un mes para ver si esto es de Dios?
Does any, in any of your verses, does it say that we're going to take a month to pray and fast to see if this is what God wants us to do? No, it says cast the net. What did they do? So they, what did they do? They cast the net.
Bueno, en el caso es que si Dios te da una instrucción, la respuesta más sensata ahora es ¿qué?
Hacer.
Obedecer.
All right, so if God gives you an instruction and you know it's an instruction from God, what should you do?
Obey it.
Obey it.
Pero muchos tenemos el problema en que Dios nos mostró algo hace qué tiempo.
Well, a lot of us have a problem that God's shown us something a long time ago.
No te extrañes porque Dios no te sorprende.
So don't be surprised if God doesn't show up in your life if you don't obey His simple commands that He's already given you.
Porque vamos a ver una ecuación muy interesante.
This is an interesting equation that we have here in this passage.
Frustración.
You have frustration.
Más Jesús aparece.
Plus Jesus appears.
Más una instrucción.
Plus instruction.
Igual.
Equals.
Lo mejor está por venir.
The best is yet to come.
Vieron toda la cantidad de peces que ya no podían sacar la red.
There was such a quantity of fish that they couldn't even pull the net into the boat.
No botas ni ramas.
There were no boots or branches.
Cuando Dios da, él da.
When God gives, He gives the best.
Versículo 18. El Señor dijo a Pedro, el discípulo a quien Jesús amaba, tan pronto como Simón. El Señor, es el Señor, dijo a Pedro, el discípulo a quien Jesús amaba. Tan pronto como Simón Pedro le oyó decir esto, es el Señor, se puso la ropa pues estaba semidesnudo y se tiró al agua.
Therefore the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. So when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put his outer garment on, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea.
Una pregunta, ¿por qué hizo esto? Pero ahora, no tengo, había que hacer. Estaba semidesnudo, pero no era una pesca nudista.
So Peter's half naked, he jumps into the water. Why did he do that? Why did Peter jump in the water?
¿Cuál era la prisa de Pedro?
What was his hurry?
¿Por qué no aguantar con los otros y llegar a la barca con ellos?
Why didn't he wait with the others and just arrive with them at the shore?
Porque tú y yo sabemos que Pedro tenía una cuenta pendiente con Jesús.
We all know that Peter had an unresolved issue with Jesus.
Vemos que Jesús ya se apareció dos veces antes y no ha arreglado con Pedro lo que sabemos tú y yo que tiene que arreglar.
He had already appeared a couple of times with the disciples and still it wasn't fixed with Peter.
Y yo me imagino a Pedro sabiendo cómo es Pedro.
I'm thinking about Peter, knowing who Peter is.
Yo me lanzo ahorita y me las adelanto porque si no es ahorita no sé para cuándo.
Probably Peter was saying, if I don't do it now, when am I going to do it?
Yo tengo que arreglar con Jesús.
It's time for me to fix this with Jesus.
Pero lo curioso es que Jesús no lo va a arreglar ahorita, lo va a arreglar la próxima semana.
Jesus will not fix it until next Sunday, but this is what maybe what Peter is thinking.
Para nosotros, para él sí lo arreglaría. Versículo 9. Al desembarcar vieron unas brasas con un pescado encima y un pan.
So when they got onto the land, they saw a charcoal fire already laid and fish placed on it and bread.
Ahora Jesús está a punto de invitarlos básicamente a desayunar y a disfrutar de los labores del fruto que produjo el Espíritu mediante ellos.
Jesus is getting ready to invite the disciples to enjoy and participate in the fruit of the labors that He's produced through them.
Pero es algo muy interesante para recordarle a Pedro lo significante de esta invitación.
But there's something really interesting here, and you really need to see this, was what Jesus does to remind Peter how significant this invitation really is.
Él usa el mismo tipo de brasas calientes sobre las cuales Pedro la tercera vez no estaba negando y calentándose sus manitas.
Remember when Peter is warming himself by a charcoal fire? Jesus is using the same type of charcoal here to cook this food.
¿No han encontrado entrado a la cocina o a un restaurante y o te da un olor y te hace recordar algo?
Remember, have you ever tied your sense of smell to your memory? So you smell something and you immediately remember something? You ever done that?
Pues Jesús quiso hacer esto con Pedro. Él sabía que en cuanto Pedro oliera estas brasas, él iba a disparar algo en su cerebro y a recordar esa situación.
This is what Jesus is doing with Peter. He knows if he smells those coals, that he's going to remember what he did that night. And Jesus is preparing this for him.
Y es muy interesante porque vemos que antes de poder ser utilizados por Jesús, tenemos que reconciliarnos con él.
It's a really interesting point for us in an application. Before being used by God, you must be reconciled to Him.
Pero otra buena noticia.
There's another bit of good news.
Él está dispuesto, nos persigue, y Él prepara.
It's the good news. You can see in this passage, Jesus is the one pursuing Peter. the one preparing the table for him.
Vieron brasas con un pescado encima y un pan.
Here's some coals with some fish on top and some bread.
¿Qué nos muestra esto?
What does this show us?
Básicamente que Jesús no nos necesita.
They've been fishing all night. He's already got fish. He doesn't need us.
Tú llegas a él y él ya tiene todo listo.
You come to him, the man's already got everything ready.
Justin Pierce dijo esto. Si tú vas a una iglesia donde te predican que Dios te necesita, huye por tu vida porque te están engañando.
Justin Peters said this: if you go to a church where they preach to you that God needs you, run for your life. Because they're lying to you.
Y es cierto, porque si nos necesitara, no fuera Dios para nosotros.
If he needed us, he would not be God.
Sería una especie de Zeus donde esta deidad creada por el hombre necesita mis oraciones porque si no deja de existir.
He'd be like some god like Zeus that I created in my mind that needs me to exist.
Él nos invita no porque nos necesite, pero porque nos ama.
He doesn't invite us because he needs us. He invites us because he loves us.
Radical diferencia.
There's a big difference between those two.
Porque vamos a ser honestos. Si tú ves tú y tus atributos y las veces que has fallado, las veces que prometes algo y no cumples, ¿quién necesita quién?
Look at yourself here for just a second. Think about who you are, your attributes, the things you've done and the things that you've not done. And then look at God and ask yourself the question, who needs who?
Pero esa es la delicia de la gracia.
This is the delight of grace.
Que no tenemos un Dios al que manejamos, sino un Dios que maneja todo el universo y nos invita a ser transformados a Él, no porque nos necesite, pero porque nos ama.
We do not have a God, folks, that you can handle. You have a God who controls the entire universe and invites you to be involved in His plan.
Él básicamente nos está invitando a desayunar.
He's inviting us this morning to do the same with Him.
Él sabe que no han pescado nada.
He knows that the disciples haven't caught anything all night.
Y no es de como que, bájense de la barca, 16 horas de oración seguidas.
He's not saying, come off the boat and we're going to pray for 12 straight hours.
O vamos a ver las dispensaciones de la Biblia.
We're going to see every dispensation in the Bible, although all of it is important.
No, es este Jesús. Es este Jesús que sabe lo que necesitamos. Dice, venga, vamos a desayunar.
He says, the first thing we're going to do is eat, because I know that's what you need right now. Here's the fish. Come and eat.
Versículo 10. Traigan alguno de los pescados que acaban de sacar, les dijo Jesús.
Verse 10. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you've now caught.
Una pregunta que es, salta aquí, yo soy muy así, y yo cuando esté allá voy a tener un buen tiempo de plática con Pedro y Juan y compañía.
Basically, what would they be talking about at breakfast?
Es de que, una cosa que estoy seguro que no fue de Pedro.
It wasn't Peter. Peter's not the one that started this, certainly.
Imagínense a Juan diciéndole a Jesús, hey, Jesús, ¿cómo viste al Pedro? Muy machito y a la mera hora.
Probably John's nudging Jesus, telling him, what about Peter over there? You remember what he did?
Pero estos son como huecos que deja la Biblia para enseñarnos que hay una realidad en la que solo somos, que solo es Dios y tú.
This is, these things we don't have here, but it's meant to show us. Here, there's an application point. Just imagine yourself being there with Jesus as you're talking to him one-on-one.
¿Y qué es lo que Dios te habla a ti que no le habla? Okay. A veces que te mando lees un texto en la Biblia y parece que Dios te lo mandó por mensaje hoy para tu mañana, para tu batalla de hoy.
When we apply the Bible this way to ourselves, we realize that Jesus is really talking to us through the Word, that he literally speaks to us through the message of the Scripture.
Traigan algunos pescados. ¿Por qué les dijo esto?
He says, bring some of the fish you've caught. Why does Jesus say that?
Yo tengo dos teorías. Una es bíblica y la otra no.
I have two theories. One is biblical, the other is whatever he's about to say.
Porque Jesús sabía que los discípulos eran bien tragones y sabía que un pescado no iba a alcanzar.
Here's the theory that comes from his mind. Because Jesus knew that the disciples were hungry and one fish was not going to suffice for everybody.
Okay, la segunda es porque ellos... Jesús sabía que ellos eran comerciantes de pescado.
Jesus knew, here's the, maybe the more biblical reason, Jesus knew that they were fishermen and that they had to live.
Y que de algo tenían que vivir. Okay, van a tener 153 peces para vender, pero por lo menos traigan unos para desayunar.
He provides for them. He says, you're going to need this to sell, to make money, and to buy what you need. It's Jesus functioning as a provider for us.
Dios no nos necesita.
Again, God doesn't need us.
Pero invitó a Pedro, Juan y compañía a disfrutar y a participar de los frutos de sus esfuerzos.
It's interesting because he says, bring now some of the fish that you have caught. Who caught them? Jesus called them, but he's allowing them to participate in the fruit of the labor that he had produced.
Y es claro, solo fructíferos por la instrucción y el poder de Dios.
Join me and participate in the fruit of the labor that I've been able.
¿Por qué? Porque sus esfuerzos sin Jesús, ¿qué podrían?
What can they produce without Jesus?
Nothing. Nada. Pero cuando Jesús llega, hacen caso, tienen frutos.
Jesus comes, and they realize it. They're participating with him in his victory.
Eso es lo que quiere hacer Jesús. Él quiere disfrutar de su victoria con nosotros.
Jesus wants to enjoy the victory that he has won with us.
Imagina que eres un deportista en lo que sea que haya torneos y que tú ganas.
Imagine that you're an athlete or something, there's a tournament or something, and you win first place.
¿Con quién vas a celebrar?
Who are you going to celebrate with?
¿Con el equipo contrario o el contrario?
You're going to find people that don't like you?
No, con los que estuvieron ahí desde el principio apoyando.
You're probably going to find people that have been there from the beginning that are now supporting you.
Jesús luchó y venció y ahora quiere hacerlos partícipes de su victoria en él.
Jesus fought and won and now wants to celebrate with his disciples. The crowds are not who he wants to be with in this moment. He wants to be with the disciples.
Sí, claro, eso, con sus discípulos, porque las multitudes ya tuvieron su oportunidad de decir si Jesús era su Señor o no. Y él aquí está tratando de, ya con los que lo aman, con los que él ama y lo ama.
He's sharing his victory and intimacy with those with whom he's intimate.
Y él quiere celebrar su victoria con nosotros, repito, no porque nos necesite, pero porque nos ama.
And he wants to do this with us not because he needs us, but because he loves us.
Simón Pedro subió a bordo y arrastró hasta la orilla de la red, la cual estaba llena de pescados de un buen tamaño. Eran 153, pero a pesar de ser tantos, la red no se rompió.
Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of large fish, 153, and although there were so many, the net was not torn.
Dando a entender que esa cantidad era una red normal, se rompía.
What would happen with a normal net with 153 fish in it? It would break.
Hay un dicho mexicano que dice, cuando Dios da, hasta presta los costales.
This is a Mexican saying, that when God gives, he even lends the sacks.
Y esta semana, escuché otro esta semana que dice, y cuando Dios quita, hasta las servilletas se llevan.
And this is another saying that he heard this week, that when God takes, he takes all the way even to the napkins.
Está bien, pero solo voy a ser el primero. Okay. 153 peces y la red nos rompía. Proverbios 10:22 dice que la bendición del Señor enriquece y no añade tristeza con ellos.
153 fish in the net that did not break. Proverbs 10:22 says it's the blessing of the Lord that makes rich and he adds no sorrow to it.
Cuando Dios nos da una instrucción, él bendice y la red no se rompe.
When God gives us an instruction, he blesses us and the net does not break.
Vamos a Ageo, un libro en el Antiguo Testamento, Ageo 1.
Everybody go to Haggai 1:5.
Now therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Just 1:5.
Mm-hmm. 5 and 6.
Oh, you want to go to prayer? Go ahead, read 6.
Okay. So it's fine. 1:5 tiene que Ageo. En medio de sofonías y sacerías. Y hasta en los mapas, ya te perdiste. Mejor ve la Biblia desde al lado. Sí.
Esto es lo que dice el Señor. Miren lo que les está pasando. Han sembrado mucho, pero cosechado poco. Comen, pero no pesan, no quedan satisfechos. Beben, pero aún tienen sed. Se abrigan, pero todavía tienen frío. Sus salarios desaparecen, como si los echaran en bolsillos de un cartel.
Reflexionen sobre su proceder. Algunas otras versiones dicen reflexionen bien sobre su.
Consider your ways. Other translations say meditate well.
Y el meditar de Dios no es como el meditar del mundo.
Meditation of God is not like meditating. It's not like meditation of the world.
Porque el mundo dice medita, pon tu mente en blanco, no pienses en nada.
Meditation in the world means get your mind blank and just fill it with whatever, you know, do the things, sit down, cross your legs, and all the rest of it.
Pero meditar de Dios no. El meditar de Dios viene de la palabra que se llama hop.
Meditation of God comes from the Hebrew word meaning hop, meaning to consider or imagine.
se le selecciona el significado de examinar, considerar, imaginar, meditar, hablar, estudiar y expresar, etcétera, etcétera.
To consider, to imagine, to meditate, to mourn, speak, study, speak, express, meditation of God would be put things on a table and analyze it.
Sí, yo sé que sería una aplicación, sería pon tu vida sobre la mesa y analiza.
So essentially what God is saying is put yourself before you and now analyze.
Cuando tú estás jugando ajedrez, ¿cómo juegas? ¿Sí?
When you're playing chess, do you play with your head under the table?
No, tú estás por arriba observando.
That's why Richard, that's why Richard. Yeah. No, of course not. You're looking over the game. You've got to analyze it.
Analiza bien. ¿Por qué?
Analyze well. Why?
Verso 6. Can you read verse 6?
Look at verse 6.
You have so much, but harvest little. You eat, but there is not enough to be satisfied. You drink, but there is not enough to become drunk. You put on clothing, but no one is warm enough.
Y ese es el síntoma de cuál los queremos ver como pastores.
That's bad. You use the phrase Spanish. ¿Quién fue el de ayer?
El 6.
Ayer, 1-6.
Otra vez el 6.
Haggai 1:6, you receive your net is broken.
Pero cuando tú eres célebre, cuando tú produces, cuando tú creas, cuando eres célebre, tú de tu historia, versículo 6.
Verse 6 of Haggai 1 happens in your life when you make yourself the story. What does it say? There's not enough to be satisfied, you drink, there's not enough to become drunk, you put on clothing, but no one's warm enough, and the one who earns wages to be put into a purse of holes. That's what happens when we're the hero of our own story.
¿Es tu caso?
Is that the case of our lives?
¿Trabajas y le das duro y recibes tu comida y sacorros?
You work, and what you receive is a purse of holes.
Y ese es un buen síntoma de que tienes que decir, ¿sabes qué? Creo que yo soy eso.
Maybe this is a symptom in your life, and maybe it's now you're in the position of the disciples to realize where you're at.
La Biblia es evidente que tú eres el héroe de tu historia y eres un héroe complicado.
We know that the Bible says that we're not the hero of our own story. To make ourselves that is to be ashamed.
Dios te está invitando a conocer al verdadero héroe, al héroe de tu historia.
God is inviting you to see who the true hero is, and the hero is Jesus.
Hay un fenómeno de cristianismo que somos como los mini luchadores. Just, do you get that picture?
Oh, sweet person. There's a phenomenon in the Christian life that we're often like midget fighters.
Oh, you don't have a midget fighter?
What?
The midget fighter?
What?
No, you don't have it. Pero han visto los luchadores, ¿no? Al salto y que están saltando, midget fighter.
Has anybody ever seen midget fighters that are really buff but super short?
Y ellos traen la misma máscara que el grande, los mismas poses.
Yeah, they come out in all the uniform they get. And actually, we're thinking about inviting Phil up, and then I stand in the middle, and it would be a good illustration. So, anyway.
Y vemos cómo nosotros somos esos mini luchadores que somos bien bravos y a la hora que nos meten al ring nos patean, nos arañan, nos pisotean, y estamos pidiéndole al verdadero héroe que entre por nosotros.
Sometimes we're exactly like they are. We go into the ring, we're thinking that we're really brave, we're fighting along, and then we realize pretty quickly that we need help. Frustration.
Aparece Jesús y te da una instrucción.
Jesus appears with an instruction.
Tú obedeces creyéndole.
You obey him and believe him.
Él te sorprende.
And he does something amazing.
Frustración.
Or the opposite. Frustration.
Aparece Jesús y te da una instrucción.
Jesus appears and gives you an instruction.
Tú no haces caso.
You don't obey him or pay attention to him.
Y sigues igual.
And you stay frustrated, broken, and tired.
Y tú podrás decir, es que llevo años de cristiano y mi vida sigue atorada.
Maybe you're saying, man, I've been a Christian for years and my life is stuck.
Podría rascarle un poquito a tu teología y decirte, ¿qué fue la última cosa que te dijo Dios que hicieras en Cristo?
Listen to this question. Listen, what's the last thing God told you to do that you've not obeyed? What's the last thing God told you to do that you've not obeyed?
Tal vez Jesús te dijo, echa la reta a la derecha. Y tú, no, a la izquierda es mejor porque el agua está más clarita para este lado.
Maybe Jesus has told you, throw your net out to the right, and you say, no, 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 you start arguing with him. No, no, the water on the left is quite a bit clear. I think I'm going to throw it over there.
Jesús te dijo, ¿sabes qué? Perdona a esta persona.
Maybe it's something like this. Jesus says, I want you to forgive this person.
Ah, no, 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 hasta que no venga y me pide perdón.
They don't come to me and ask for forgiveness, that I can't give it to them.
Bueno, la Biblia dice perdonar, así como él te perdonó. Y él lo hizo muchísimo antes de que tú nacieras hace 2,000 años en la cruz.
But think about what he's done for you. He died on the cross to forgive you of your sins, and now he's saying to you, obey me. Don't throw, I'm telling you, throw, I'm telling you where to throw your net. Obey me.
Quizás es mejor de que tu vida está atorada, es de que tú la atoraste. Esta instrucción es muy gráfica. Esta instrucción es muy gráfica si la realidad es esta.
He gives very graphic instructions, and the reality is this.
Ante un Dios que te ama,
before a God who loves you,
él es digno de que tú le creas por quien es él.
He's worthy that you believe him for who he is.
Ya casi terminamos. Cuando Jesús se celebra en tu historia, la red no se rompe.
When Jesus is the hero of your story, the net doesn't break.
Cuando tú eres el héroe de tu historia, recibes tu jornal y saco pronto.
But when you're the hero of your story, you receive your wage and the broken side.
Por ende, cinco cosas que vimos hoy.
Five things that we've seen today.
Número uno. Jesús quiere manifestarte en tu vida. Y dice, la lectura de la palabra debe tener siempre este propósito.
Jesus wants to manifest himself in your life, just like he did with the disciples. The reading of the word must always have this purpose.
Si tú cuando abres tu Biblia no hay un atributo de Jesús que te atraiga a cambiar y a seguirlo.
If you open your Bible and you don't see any attributes of Jesus that cause you to want to follow him.
Perdóname que te demienta tu teatrito, pero tú no amas ni conoces.
Maybe you're not knowing Jesus. Maybe you're not loving him the way that you should. And that's why you're not seeing anything in the scriptures.
Número dos.
Number two.
La frustración y el fracaso temporal son una oportunidad para confesar que no tenemos nada sin Jesús.
Frustration and temporary failure are an opportunity to confess that we have nothing without Jesus.
Número tres.
Number three.
La obediencia ante la instrucción es una evidencia del discípulo.
Obedience to God's instruction is evidence of being a disciple.
Y desde eso, los discípulos no obedecieron porque para ser salvos, obedecieron porque ya amaban a Jesús.
They did not obey because they were trying to be saved. They obeyed because they were worthy.
Y eso es lo que debemos aprender. De negarnos a nosotros mismos. Porque cuando tú estás, a lo que yo le llamo el reino de ti mismo.
When you're living in your own kingdom.
Yo soy el rey de mi vida. Yo soy el señor de mí. Todo.
You're going to live like you're the king of your own life, but Jesus called you to die to yourself.
¿Sabes qué? No hay peor tirano.
There's no worse tyrant than yourself when you're trying to be king over your own life.
Número cuatro.
Number four.
Jesús no nos necesita a nadie, pero nos invita a participar del fruto de nuestro esfuerzo bajo su instrucción, su poder y su victoria.
Jesus does not need anyone but invites us to participate in the fruit of what he has accomplished through us by his power and his victory.
Número cinco.
Number five.
Un síntoma a considerar.
There's a symptom to consider.
Y reconociéndolo, correr hacia nuestro redentor.
As we recognize that we should run to our Redeemer. The symptom is making ourselves the hero of our history.
Y ese es el punto del sermón, que si tú ves y piensas que esto te está pasando a ti, no te escondas en la culpa. Corre hacia tu redentor.
You see this happening to you. You see yourself, and Jesus is now asking you to see your situation. He's bringing this to light. Don't run to your guilt. Run to him.
Y esto no es para que tú te sientas mal. Si esto causa que tú te sientas mal, yo erré como comunicador y predicador.
This is not meant to make people just feel bad in your sin.
Es para que tú corras a él.
It's to invite you to run to him. Because he's waited, he's prepared, and has pursued you.
Y si alguien está así esta mañana, por favor, está Doug, tú y yo, está Phil, está Chris, tenemos un equipo tremendo.
We're here this morning to talk to you. If you're dealing with stuff this morning, you need to talk, you're dealing with your own salvation, you're dealing with your own sin issues, please come talk to us. That's why we're here. We want to pray with you. We want to do whatever it takes to get you to the end of this.
Okay,
let's pray.